Live from the Rant Radio Network.
You're listening to Real Estate Rant with your host, Alex Alanis, and my co-host,
Miss Lisa Lombardi. No problem, just solutions for real estate needs.
Hot topics and controversial chat. We're back here at the Real Estate Rant. Here's the towers of the Rant Radio Network. I'm your host, Mr. Alex Alanis, and in-house today, we have Mr. Which I Can, and I won't even attempt to say your last name, which I just because I might get it wrong. So I'll do the short version of that.
Once we get through the conversation, maybe I'll tell you how people used to recall my name when they were kids.
Oh, okay. There you go. There you go. And also in-house today, we have Ms. Giselle Mata. She is here from a couple of organizations, from ACE and also from ACN, which there is a subject matter today that we've been talking about that involves, I believe, one of the entrepreneurs of one of the companies you belong to, and if I may, ACN.
Okay.
Great. Right on. So give us a call, 855-693-4897. We are doing something a little different today. I did mention this on Facebook. Lisa wasn't able to join us today. Her dad is battling with cancer, and she is visiting some individuals to potentially find a cure for some of that, and she's exploring those options. So I thought that was pretty good. So our blessings are with Lisa today and our prayers.
Big shout out to Lisa and her dad.
Yeah, for sure. And I will say this, that Giselle has prayed with us a few times. Very powerful individual, Giselle. Amen. Right on. Very, very powerful prayers that we've gotten from Giselle a few times. Very touching, I might say. So anyway, I did mention the phone number. You can give us a call and interject with us anytime. You can also email us at realestaterantradio@gmail.com. And just to quickly pay the bills, Real Estate Rant and AJR and Associates would like to mention Mount Sierra College, located at 101 East Huntington Drive in Monrovia. They can be reached at 626-873-2144. Their motto, collaborate, innovate, and transform. And also, you can win a $25 gift card to Stevens Steakhouse, located in the City of Commerce, compliments of Eddie Tafoya and the Commerce Industrial Council. That gift card can be won if you happen to call in, have a question for myself, Wichai, or Giselle. Today we have Wichai and Giselle have both volunteered to come in and have an open forum with us and give us their opinion as to certain subject matters, whether it be controversial matters or current events that are going on. So we have not been prepped for this. So if you happen to call and give us your opinions, we'd like to hear from you. 855-693-4897. So a quick introduction, if we will. Let's start with Wichai. Why not?
No, before we get started, I would love to say on a great day like today, today we get to honor those who protect us and for those who let us live our dreams. One of the biggest benefits that we have is knowing that we have such a wonderful team of individuals in our armed forces that protect us and allow us to do what we do. So first off, I want to say, thank you for everybody serving. Yes, my name is Wichai Can. I'm a triplet and I work for Residential Bancorp. Love to be opinionated and happy to be here.
Right on. So quick, Wichai, how do we get a hold of you?
You can get a hold of me at 714-866-9333. Residential Bancorp is the company, and the email address is wecan@bancorp.com.
And who is your target market? What kind of business or what kind of individual would be good client for yourself?
Well, we cater to individuals that are looking to build dreams and search for homes. But during that process, we'd like to vet them out, make sure that they understand that it's the biggest investment they're going to make. And when we do that, we sit down with them and make sure that we not only look at from a mortgage perspective of how much they qualify, but how they're going to live throughout that process. So if anybody that's looking to, buy a home, but yet make sure that it's sustainable over time, those are our clients. We like to make sure we educate them. So.
Yeah, so kind of the reverse of predatory lending, right? Yeah. I mean, that's kind of like what you just said. Wouldn't you agree, Giselle?
Yeah, I agreed.
That predatory lending was about, hey, this is information that's not being disclosed to the buyers. This is information that's not necessarily
a setup.
I mean, for lack of a better word, okay. So what you're saying is that you're now taking that same arena, if you will, and you're allowing your clients to have that information. You're making sure that they're having that information. I actually heard you say that you make sure that they know those things.
I think that's the biggest misconception we have as when they call us MLOs or mortgage loan originators. We're not originators, we're educators. So if we're going to use anything, we're going to use MLE. Because at the end of the day, if we can educate a client, we can educate them not only on their current situation, but on their future situation. Because overall, their investment, the most important investment any individual will ever make, is a home. The next biggest thing is a car, stock, bonds, annuities, or another home. So in order for them to live the dream and be able to, you know, stand this test of time, it's education that helps.
Nice. All right, so in terms of now what you do, how long have you been doing it? How long have you been in the lending business?
I've been in the lending industry since 1999.
99, yeah. Okay, so you've been through some ups and downs. Absolutely. In the industry. We've watched the mortgage meltdown. We've seen now a healthy recovery. And we were just talking off the air a little bit about how we've seen kind of the values of homes kind of bounce back a bit. And that's kind of... a foundation, if you will, for a better economy.
Absolutely. Right? I mean, and stability has to go hand in hand. So you're seeing right now rates are still at an all-time low, but it's not going to last forever. We have to have some sort of balance within our industry. And, you know, as much as I want to say that rates are still going to continue to stay low, there's going to be an offset. There's going to be an offset supply and demand. You're seeing that soon we will have more flexibility. But it's really making sure that we educate our consumer on knowing, you know, what's best for them overall.
So, which I have to ask this question. Let me play devil's advocate here for a second, because I do that a lot, okay?
No.
Yeah, exactly. In terms of the interest rates going up, I mean, the interest rates were created to control inflation. Why wouldn't we see them going up a little bit more frequently, mainly because we don't want to see home values get out of control again? That's kind of what happened in the 2000s.
Yeah, you know, you see a lot of individuals think that the same thing's going to happen again. I think this time around, we're prepared for it. You know, with TRID coming out, with all these new guidelines that come out and didn't know before you owe, it won't happen this time. You know, yes, you have these rumblings about these stated incomes coming back, but the true reality of it is if you want a qualified mortgage, if you want to be able to know that you're going to be able to sell that off into Freddie Mac, Ginnie Mae, or whoever's going to be end up buying it, you know they have to be it has to be a QM, or it's called a qualified mortgage. All of those are full docs. All of those are fully documenting everything now to make sure that we're looking out for not only the investor, but most importantly, the consumer.
Nice. Okay, well, Which, I thank you for joining us here, which I will be including his opinions and rants, if you will, on the show today on the different subject matters that we happen to be talking about. And I thought that would be an interesting topic a little bit here at the beginning of the show. But let's flip over to Giselle. How are you, young lady?
Great.
Okay, now Giselle's been on the show, I want to say 4 times, if I remember correctly.
This will be my third.
This will be the third mm-hmm. time. Okay. Because we did the one with Peggy, mm-hmm. and then we did another one, I believe for ACN, if I remember correctly.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, and then recently we did one, I want to say a couple months ago.
Oh, sure. Yeah, 4 times.
So it was 4. Well, yeah. So this would be the 4th.
This will be the 4th, yeah.
Got it. Okay. So Giselle is somewhat of a veteran. Mm-hmm. And I watched shows that were pretty good. They were informative, and yeah, there was a lot of good information. So Giselle, a little bit about yourself.
Right. Giselle Mata. I'm from Whittier, local girl. Have my own business, plus I work with a nonprofit, Alliance of California for Community Empowerment. It's a neighborhood organization that focuses on low to moderate income families, middle class families that are struggling, can partner with our organization and have a ground up kind of organizing to where the members get to dictate what we move on. And members are passionate about a lot of things. Housing justice is one of many. Worker justice is another. And really, they kind of dictate, the members dictate what we do.
Yeah, but what does that mean? When you say housing justice, I mean, I picture a bunch of people with pitchforks out there, you know, and torches, you know, trying to flame somebody up. I mean, is that...
Well, it takes $34 an hour
to rent
a one-bedroom apartment in L.A.
$34?
Currently.
$34 an hour.
You need to make at least $34 an hour to rent a one-bedroom apartment in Los Angeles.
Now, allow me to play devil's advocate again.
Sure.
Because when you say $34 an hour, it also includes other costs of living, not just the an apartment, say.
Right. Of course, you have to factor in living situations, whereas, you know, you're just covering your overhead. It's not really, you know, a real estimate of what things cost, right? Because you've got utilities and you've got food and obviously.
Yeah, well, because I was going to say at $34 an hour, I'm in the wrong business, right?
I'm just saying, when it comes to, you know, people that are on the opposite end of the spectrum, when they say, you know, what's housing justice? Well, if you need $34 an hour to rent,
I'm still picturing that pitchfork
to rent an apartment. I think, you know, there's a good conversation about what the cost of living is compared to what it takes to put a roof over your head.
Well, let me ask, where does that figure come from?
It actually comes from data that's been done over the entire state, you know, not just the state, actually nationwide.
So this is the state of California saying this?
Yeah. Yeah, right, I actually have the entity that tracks that, which is the National Employment Labor Project.
Oh, nice.
So
are we talking about just LA County? Are we talking about?
Oh, yeah, just LA City.
So other counties are different, locally speaking, somebody in Riverside, Orange County.
But you can see that it's going to have a ripple effect, because obviously if the concentration of gentrification, you know, properties that are being flipped in LA, or the rents are going up because you have newer properties, and so the cost of obviously is going to go up. It's going to have a ripple effect, because the existing communities are now having to have a mass exodus because they can no longer afford to live in the city, but they're working in the city. So the surrounding cities are going to absorb the communities that are now priced out of the LA market. But again, supply and demand. So if that supply starts to dwindle, demand goes up, and that's going to dictate the price is going to move up as well for surrounding counties. Right?
Well, Giselle, I happen to know that you answer to a higher source, because you are a volunteer for your effort. Is that correct?
I actually work part-time. So 20 hours a week is what I do. And so in essence, there are some times to where I'm there volunteering, but I started off as a volunteer.
I see.
That's a fact.
So the second year of, I was an ACE member first, because I had my own fight for my house. And after I won that fight with ACE, I realized that I need to pay it forward and show people how to advocate for themselves and create justice in their own case. And so in doing that, it's allowed me to meet some really great people and help them to find a way to save their home.
We are coming up on a break. We'll be right back.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back with some more Real Estate Rant.
Real Estate Rant and AGR Realtors are proud supporters of Michael Aguilar and Associates, advocates for stroke awareness and integrative health care.
In February 2012, I suffered a stroke due to high blood pressure. I was rushed to the hospital, where I was admitted for the next 30 days. I was initially told I may have to stay in the hospital for about 3 months, but I made rapid improvements in my recuperation and continue to improve to this day.
When Michael left the hospital, he did not have insurance to cover his rehabilitation, so he focused on integrative healthcare to get better. At the end of 2013, seeing a need for stroke awareness, Michael started his own company, Michael Aguilar and Associates, to focus on creating awareness about the dangers of high blood pressure and stroke.
If you would like more information, please call me at 562-464-7297, or you can visit my website at www.strokeawareness101.com.
Michael Aguilar and Associates, creating awareness and saving lives one person at a time.
Do we have your attention? When it comes to tequila, two things matter: heart and passion. Never compromising integrity for mass production. Number One Tequila delivers the goods. Taste the heart and passion of Mexico in every bottle. We make it right. We make it fun. Superior Tequila. There's only Number One. There's only Number One. There's only Number One.
Been in an accident? Then you need your vehicle professionally repaired. That's exactly what you'll get when you bring your vehicle to Greg's Auto Body Repair. Free quotes within minutes. We'll provide everything you need for a hassle-free auto body repair, from an accurate estimate to working with your insurance company. We will get your vehicle to its pre-accident condition as soon as possible. Greg's Auto Body has been serving Los Angeles County and local cities since 1970. Call us at 562-789-1300.
A home is the biggest investment in most people's lives. Buying or selling should be a positive experience.
Whether you want to be a wealthy real estate investor or just trying to find a place to call home, at AJR & Associates, we focus on the client's needs.
We understand the market better than most. Let us bring the value to you and make the right choice.
AJR & Associates, making your dream house a reality. Call us today for a free consultation at 562-882-1976. Or you can log on to www.hgrrealtors.com.
With a track record of great results, bringing knowledge, wisdom, and expertise to you. Hablamos Español.
Thanks for tuning in to Real Estate Rant Radio.
Make sure to join us every Wednesday at 3:30 p.m. on the Rant Radio Network,
where we talk about solutions to your real estate problems.
And we are back here at the Real Estate Rant, here at the towers of the Rant Radio Network. Station identification, you're currently listening to iRant Radio on the Rant Radio Network, the new and interactive way of getting information, music, laughs, and controversy. How's that, Mr. Pantalones? You like that? All right. Give us a call at 855-693-4897, or you can email us at realestateRantRadio@gmail.com. We will not get to your emails during the show, but we'll try to get to them at subsequent shows. Real Estate Rant and AJR & Associates are proud sponsors of Michael Aguilar & Associates and Stroke Awareness. You can reach, we call him Uncle Mike here at the studio, www.strokeawareness101.com, or you can email him at michaelpaguilar@hotmail.com. You can also win a $25 gift card to Stevens Steakhouse located in the City of Commerce, compliments of Eddie Tafoya and the Commerce Industrial Council. If you call that number, if you happen to be watching, it will be up on the screen. You can also listen.
Who's your daddy?
Yeah, exactly. You can also to listen to the show, and I will give you the number again, 855-693-4897. You will have an opportunity to win that $25 gift card if you call myself, which I or Giselle. If you happen to have a question, a rant, you want to say something about what it is that we're talking about, please feel free to call in. So, done with the introductions. We know who everyone is, except for me, possibly. But at the end of the day... Oh, what are we doing? All right, we're good. How's that?
You're adjusting
so,
something.
Yeah, so we're getting some adjustments here, some technical adjustments. So what should we start for, guys? What do you think? I have some subject matter. I think Giselle had a good subject that she wanted to bring up. Giselle, what's going on in Pico Rivera?
Well... we have some Walmart employees, over 500 Walmart employees lost their job in a matter of 48 hours over the summer.
And that was what, about four months ago, I
mm-hmm.
think?
Yeah.
And it was just out of the blue, right?
It was about 6 months ago, because it's exactly long enough of a time frame to where Walmart would not have to hire back the employees that were unionizing.
Oh, I see. So,
yeah,
so
California state law dictates that they have to be closed exactly 6 months in order for them to not have to, you know, legally hire back the employees that were left without a job and within 48 hours notice from closing that location.
So there was something going on in the background here where they thought, I mean, I don't know who we're talking about exactly, but the powers that be in Walmart thought that They were the employees that were trying to unionize, so they kind of pulled their muscle and said, "We're closing the store."
Well, there was going to be a full-on press conference and rally at the location 2 days before they announced the closure for plumbing reasons. They announced the closure basically 2 days before a rally was going to take place in a press conference regarding worker justice at Walmart.
Have you ever shopped there? Do you ever shop at the one in Pico?
No. I've been there in the past when they first opened, but not recently.
I always knew it was really busy because anytime mm-hmm. I went in there, mm-hmm. it was difficult to get parking.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't matter what time of the day because they were open 24 hours. You go inside and the place was just packed with people.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say that most of the registers were open at any given time.
Okay.
So let's kind of delve into a bit. I'm not a Walmart employee, but I can guess that these individuals are probably making minimum wage, and I know that was one of your fights for a little while,
right?
Or probably still are.
Still is.
With some of the new changes that are coming up in minimum wage, but the individuals that are working there, and there's a lot of employees that work there, are probably not making very much money.
Right.
Do you think that was their argument in terms of trying to unionize?
Well, I think it is probably a lot of different things, but just in talking with some of the workers there, I think it had to do with just not just low wages, but lack of training, lack of promoting, you know, within the store. Also, you know, set schedules, you know, predictable schedules would kind of the norm. There was a lot of things that were going on, but I think more importantly, you know, would be to hear it from a Walmart worker rather than, you know, just coming from me. But from what I understand, there was a lot of issues that ranged not just from the wages that they were receiving, but the fact that they weren't, you know, being offered full-time help, more part-timers were being brought on so they would avoid paying the health insurance and things like that, where, you know, you have families that rely on, you know, the income that they get and the medical insurance in order to survive and not have to go into the government-funded programs. But those weren't being offered at the time. So what you have is a failure, you know, to offer full-time work by, you know, not just, you know, wages, but full-time work is obviously better for folks that need insurance. And that wasn't, you know, their reality, unfortunately.
You know, I remember this whole area, that whole block, if you will, of where that mall is at.
Right.
It used to be, I believe, a Northrop.
It was a Northrop
facility.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then they closed it down, tore it down, and they went in and built this stuff. I mean, this is stuff that I think that the local governments and the municipalities bring these facilities in to help the community. You know, they're creating jobs. They're creating ability to not have to drive to other cities to go to Walmart or to go to some of these areas. And Walmart having the power that they have to have the ability to just, you know, pull the rag out from under them. I mean, Richai, what do you think, man?
Well, that's an interesting one because, you know, trying to go back to living a philosophy, going back to an old bartering system where it's the community, it's us, you know, I know you, you know me, let's barter, let's do business, let's trade and stuff such and so forth.
Yeah, yeah.
That is the true reality of building a community. And the true reality is Walmart's not here. Walmart's not in Pico Rivera.
Oh, good. You know, that's exactly the point that I was trying to make, although I didn't quite say it that way, but that's exactly what I was thinking. I was thinking, hey, you know, they really shouldn't have the right to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's just my opinion. They shouldn't have the right to pull the rug out from under us and have the ability to stretch their muscle. You know, it's one of those things, and this is one of the subject matters that I brought up that I want to bring up later on is about the separation between the poor and the rich. And I think that's a perfect example.
Now, when we talk about the poor and the rich, we also talk about the powers that we have as individuals. Because one of the reasons why I feel that Walmart shut down 48 hours before a rally is because of the power of our voices. That's how big Walmart really understood that, listen, if we get enough people, enough of our community voicing an opinion, something will happen. And, you know, that's the one takeaway I will say is, listen, don't ever forget the power of our voices and the power of our community to be able to build our community within and organically build this community. And I think not so good on Walmart's part for doing it, but strategically planned.
Well, let me play devil's advocate there. Okay. So let's talk about Walmart for a second. I mean, I haven't looked at their financial statements or anything like that, but I'm assuming that they're doing well. I mean, understanding that if you want to buy something inexpensive, you go to Walmart to get a good deal on whatever it is, whether it be groceries and it could be other commodities and things, but I've seen documentaries on the issues with the trade that's going on with China or not going on with China that was really contracted with them. And Walmart had a lot to do with that. also, you know, the closing down of American companies. And so there's, you know, the voice that you're talking about also has another voice, and that's just necessity.
So I would agree with that, but the necessity could still be from within. The necessity could still be resolved from an inner community of knowing needs and wants of what's going on here and now. Walmart is looking at a macro picture, not looking at the micro of each community.
Yeah, because this wasn't the only Walmart that was closed. I think there was five of them.
Six total
mm-hmm. in different states, or was it any out of the country?
All out of the states, in different states in the U.S. Yeah.
And so this was, like you said, this is a strategic move. This is a chess move on their part. And watching all of this happen really is it's paramount to what I think is going on in Pico Rivera and to that community, because how did it impact to the community?
Well, you got to consider not over 530 families lost that income all in a matter of 24 hours. What did those families have to do? They had to either go on unemployment, take out food stamps, apply for subsidized programs. So it has a ripple effect on our economy. But think of the sales tax dollars that Pico Rivera lost in those 6 months, how that devastated that community's schooling, you know, their whatever their sales tax was going to, and I'm assuming it's education. Those cities and those schools need that money. And as a, you know, as a corporation in Pico Rivera, they had a responsibility to be at least honest about what their situation was. If it wasn't about plumbing, what was it about? Because we know
are we saying that there wasn't a plumbing problem?
Alex, they never pulled any permits for plumbing work from the city. You have to pull for an extensive job that requires 6 months of activity.
Well, if they're closing down a store, right?
Right. You got to pull permits on the city, and they never did. Wow. So, I mean, it's just it's unfortunate when you have so many, you know, families that were devastated, but you got to think of the bigger picture too when you consider what they did to the city.
Yes, yes. Interesting position on that. You know, the whole Walmart thing. I think that the situation with Walmart is probably just a microcosm of what's going on in the U.S. Right. And we hear, I don't know if you guys heard the debates last night, but I heard a lot of that being said last night from the candidates about how they're going to deal with taxes and what's going on now with some of the corporate structures and how they're taxing. Most of them are talking about a flat tax, but you, Giselle, you mentioned that money, those monies are already in place and are being circulated in the communities. But when stuff like this happens, just because somebody wakes up in the morning and decides that they don't want to be strong-armed, because that's what it sounds like, that it potentially can harm the community.
Yeah, <This guy. laughs> yeah. I mean, it harms the community in serious ways. You have to kind of figure, you know, what kind of regulation can you put into place that's going to not only protect those communities and provide for jobs, but there is a balance in there. And right now, the balance is shifted entirely to the corporations.
All right. Well, we are coming up on a break.
Stay tuned. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with some more Real Estate Rants.
It's one thing to own a business, it's another to promote it. That's why thousands of business owners rely on Monster Marketing Group. Design, print, mail, custom mailers, all for as little as 29 cents delivered. That includes postage. Send to a neighborhood, zip code, or an entire city. With just a simple call, 888-49-MONSTER, you can easily promote your business, sales, events, grand openings, send coupons, and much more.
Your mail delivers in as little as 5 days. No dealing with the mailing list or paperwork. Monster Marketing does all the heavy lifting. Get started now by calling 888-49-MONSTER or go to monsterng.com.
Monster Marketing Group. We deliver. We give you results. We can prove it.
Real Estate Rant and AGR Realtors are proud supporters of Michael Aguilar and Associates, advocates for stroke awareness and integrative health care.
In February 2012, I suffered a stroke due to high blood pressure. I was rushed to the hospital where I was admitted for the next 30 days. I was initially told I may have to stay in the hospital for about 3 months, but I made rapid improvements in my recuperation and continued to improve to this day.
When Michael left the hospital, he did not have insurance to cover his rehabilitation, so he focused on integrative healthcare to get better. At the end of 2013, seeing a need for stroke awareness, Michael started his own company, Michael Aguilar and Associates, to focus on creating awareness about the dangers of high blood pressure and stroke.
If you would like more information, please call me at 562-464-7297, or you can visit my website at www.strokeawareness101.com.
Michael Aguilar and Associates, creating awareness and saving lives one person at a time.
The experts know that for pastry, Baker's Bodega has it all. Exclusive brands like Westco Bankmark, Satin Ice, and Pastry Pride. One-on-one day seminars for cake decorating and gelatin art. So for our service, wide range of ingredients and supplies, and for the low prices, Baker's Bodega has it all. But you don't need to be an expert. Baker's Bodega, 7869 Paramount Boulevard in Pico Rivera. Come, we're waiting for you.
It's hot out here. I need a drink.
Have a mucho macho michelada.
What's a michelada?
Michelada is a Mexican Bloody Mary made with beer. All you have to do is get bucket-sized michelada, open it up, pour it in your favorite beer, and you're good.
What if you don't like beer?
You can use it in lemon-lime soda, vodka with lime, or tequila with lemon-lime soda.
Sounds delicious.
Where do you find it? You can find it at your favorite store, or you can go to muchomachomichelada.com.
Find us on Twitter and Facebook.
Thanks for tuning in to Real Estate Rant Radio.
Make sure to join us every Wednesday at 3:30 p.m. on the Rant Radio Network,
where we talk about solutions to your real estate problems.
And we are back here at the Real Estate Rant, here at the towers of the Rant Radio Network. I'm your host, Mr. Alex Alanese. In-house today, we have Mr. Which I Can. And Mr. Which I Can mentioned something earlier on the show, and I didn't think you had an opportunity to say it. What was the easy way that, as a child now, in your
Ooh, how I Samson. Used to get in a lot of fights when I was a kid.
Is that what would happen?
No. You know what? Growing up as a kid, it was very difficult to have a name like mine. But as I get older, it became more of a conversation starter. But quick inside joke, when my friends would introduce me. By the way, my real name is Which I Can't Thavorn. And the way my good old buddies would introduce me would say his name is Which I Can't Touch the Porn. So
that created the fights, I can tell. Yeah.
But you know, nowadays it's more of a conversation getter, and I enjoy my name now.
Well, I love it to death. And you know, you hear so much of the regular names that when you hear an out of the ordinary name,
that's terribly sexy.
Absolutely, it becomes a staple. It becomes a character. You know exactly who that person is now.
Well, yeah, you know, I've had the name has now allowed me to use instead of being a first and last name, I consider myself like Jordan now, because now I'm not Which I Can't. I'm just Which I.
Just Which I, yeah. Yeah, like Bruce
hey,
Lee, right?
Show me some respect, boy.
Also in house today, we have Ms. Giselle Mata with the ACE organization. Is also, I believe you do ACN as well. Do you still mm-hmm. do that? Okay. Yeah. And Giselle has joined us as a opinionated individual of the community here locally in Whittier. And I wanted to welcome both of you once again. We are at the top of the hour, third segment of the show. You can log on to www.rantradionetwork.com to watch the show every Wednesday at 3 o'clock. We have a new time. And we don't always have the open forums. Today, we're trying a new thing where we're trying to address controversial issues as well as current events that might be going on, as well as anything that comes to mind. You know, feel free to interject anytime. Give us a call, 855-693-4897. If you happen to call in, you can win a $25 gift card at Stevens Steakhouse, located in the City of Commerce, compliments of Eddie Tafoya and the Commerce Industrial Council. And you can also email us at realestaterantradio@gmail.com. So that said, we were talking a little bit about Walmart. Interesting conversation, guys. I'll be honest with you. That's all good stuff. So let's finish up with that, because what's going on now? There's something that's going to happen currently that's coming up.
Yeah, actually, Walmart workers are actually planning to have a very large event over there next week. So we look forward to supporting them.
Are they opening the store again?
Yeah. So the store is actually, they're hiring right now.
And have you heard as to why, you know, why are they doing that?
Well, we know that they're not hiring back folks that were formerly there. I mean, I know personally some of the, you know, kids that went to El Rancho that work there, they're trying actively to get their jobs back, but they're not, for some reason, not being hired back. I don't know. So,
Giselle, are your feet touching the floor right now?
Yeah.
Okay. It's because you're doing it's like a little girl, you know. I'm just a little girl.
No, not a little girl.
Just teasing you.
Yeah. It's very interesting with the dynamic that's playing out, but we want to have, you know, those employees that were so deeply impacted to have a voice and to tell their story and to share what their experience has been like, because ultimately it comes down to not what corporations need, it's what our communities need and what the people that live and work in those communities would like to see happen.
Is ACE getting involved in all that? I mean,
we partner with the Walmart workers to make sure that, you know, we have an opportunity to support those individuals that are being so deeply impacted. Yeah.
And Mr. Petalones, I think we have some pictures of some of those individuals, not necessarily on strike, but I did see some strike banners that they had put up. Yeah, so they're starting to organize out there. This is a picture actually from Pico Rivera, and they're already starting to do that. And yeah, wow.
Some of the yellow t-shirts are Ace Action community members.
And what does the green stand for? Do you know what
the green mart are the Walmart workers.
Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah. Those are the workers.
Yeah.
Right on. So, our blessings and prayers for those individuals, and hopefully Walmart can grow a heart out of this and see what can be done there for the community.
Wait a minute. You're right.
I believe they're rich enough. I think they could possibly allow for some fair and just wages and opportunities for those employees that help support their neighborhood stores.
Yeah, because if you look at it from the other end, we talked on break that I believe one of the richest one of the richest females. That wasn't a pun. one of the richest females in the U.S. is the daughter of the founder of Walmart.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when you're in that kind of position where you have so much money, do you really have to attack the little guy at the end of the day? You have to attack him in a way that's pretty much going to pull the carpet out from under them, mm-hmm. just because you're not going to make more. I mean,
this is Sparta!
Exactly.
I think that's the difficult thing about looking at just one perspective, the macro side of something, because she's, you know, as Walmart's trying to just monopolize everything, they don't take time to really look at the individual communities that they truly affect. And that sometimes could be the downfall of such a big corporation.
Yeah, but which idea? I mean, honestly, do you think that they don't know what they're doing? I mean, I think that they know fully what's going on, and they really don't care.
I could agree with it. They know what's fully going on, but when you think about how much how many industries revolve around money. I mean, that's truly what we live by.
It's
money.
Not all industries,
every industry, you could see. The decisions they make. But now, obviously, you know, have the thoughtfulness of knowing, you know, remember, you're responsible for these individuals. You brought them on board to take care of your company that's in a different state, that is in a community that they live in. And then, you know, it all kind of just, you close doors just for plumbing issues. Think about those individuals and think about how we could bring them back and say, okay, well, we reopened. Let's try to see if we could maximize our old relationships. And that's what it's all about. It's building relationships.
You know, growing up now, going through school and now getting out of school, you have to make a decision on what you're going to do. And I think a lot of people, they come to a crossroads. Do I want to be a worker bee, if you will, or do I want to be an entrepreneur? And I want to be like head of state. Did I just say that? Head of a company, right? A lot of us take that other path where we're going to be a worker. We're going to be humble in our position because we don't necessarily want the headaches of what is involved in being an entrepreneur. So now you have a situation where let's say we take the latter where we want to be an entrepreneur in a business.
we're okay with the headaches. We can stomach the ups and downs. We can put up with the bad things that happen in business, because it happens.
Absolutely.
Okay, but I think that those individuals also have a responsibility. If you're going to use the other segment of society, and you want, well, I say the word use, but what I mean by that is that they're now partners in that business. Those individuals have a responsibility for those people. And that, to me, was totally irresponsible.
And that's a difficult thing about being able to control both working in the business and on the business. Because when you work on the business, you work on growth. When you work in the business, you're thinking about, you know, your everyday.
Oh, good point.
So how do you balance that? And sometimes the dollar kind of leans to its favor.
Yeah.
And
you know, I would love to hear from a Walmart official, because or somebody that would talk about this with us, because, you know, there's always the position that, hey guys, if we did not do this, it was gonna end anyway, because of, you know, what was being organized, whatever. But I'm not hearing that anywhere. I didn't hear that from any of the publications. I didn't read any of that come across. So all I heard was really basically a lie telling me, hey, this is a plumbing issue. I mean, I even heard rumors about this Walmart was going to be some kind of holding tank for vigilantes, you know, because there was going to be some financial debacle and they would have to put all these individuals in there like a jail. And, you know, really, come give me a break, you know, not around here, not in these times.
We don't want to talk about financial breakdown or
crashes. Well, exactly.
But we do know that.
So enough of that. I think we killed that horse. So anyway, I wanted to talk a little bit about, and this kind of goes along the line of what we were talking about. There's a gap between the rich and the poor. And let me just read something here. This is something that I pulled off the internet that is becoming more and more true as we're coming out of a bad situation, or what we come to know as the mortgage meltdown. Okay, the gap between the rich and the poor. Widening income inequity presents some opportunities for real estate at the upper and lower ends. For example, discount stores, so the 99-cent stores, and luxury retailers are thriving. Developers are chasing high-end housing and affordable apartments. But there are fewer opportunities in the middle, and the wealth gap is making it harder for young people to buy houses or start businesses. And I see that being true. Me being out in the market, I am finding individuals that are qualified to buy homes, and which I think you and I have done some of these. But when we talk about the amounts, they don't qualify for literally the median house price range in LA or Orange County. Excuse me. So, yeah, please.
And so, you know, that is interesting, because you are right. We have had a lot of consumers that, you know, have great stability, but the way that the prices of these homes have raised over times, you got to figure 2 years ago it rose about 18%, last year about 15 to 14%, and this year kind of tapered off. This year you saw a little bit, like around 5 to 8%, but it's still at an all-time high. You got to think about, we are now at the average home prices that we were in 2008 during the crash. So understanding that we our values went up, but our cost of living or the amount that we bring in did not. And so that's the biggest concern we have right now, is how can we fluctuate and how can we bring our low earners into, and I believe we're already doing it. I think minimum wage is going to soon be $15 an hour, but it's not enough.
Yeah, but don't you think, with the whole minimum wage thing, and this is the argument on the other side, and I know Giselle and I don't necessarily see eye to eye on this issue, that it's going to create situations, and I'll have to bring this up on the next segment. So we are coming up on a break. We'll see you at the.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back with some more real estate rants.
Looking for a delicious, fresh family meal that's ready when you are and easy on your budget? Welcome to Piara Pizza. We make our pizzas with handmade dough, 100% real cheese, and tomato sauce blended with our own spices. Nothing is ever frozen. We always have large pepperoni and cheese pizzas fresh and waiting for you for only $5. Or choose one of our specialty pizzas. We have veggie, meat lovers, supreme, and Hawaiian. Add an order of our amazing hot wings, cheesy bread, or breadsticks. Our locations are ultra-modern, ultra-clean, and open 7 days a week. Visit any one of our locations today. Or check us out on the web at www.piarapizza.com. Piara Pizza. Fresh, hot, and ready for you when you come in. Stop in for your Piara Pizza today.
ProTech Carpet Tile and Care provides professional cleaning services for carpet, tile, grout, upholstery, and fine area rugs.
ProTech technicians are professionally trained and certified cleaning and restoration experts.
We specialize in restoring damage caused by heavy soil and odor.
We can remove challenging spots such as coffee, tea, ink, gum, wine, and many more.
We have saved our customers thousands of dollars on new flooring and furniture expenses with our advanced cleaning processes.
Call for a free estimate at 562-447-4300 and visit us on our website, www.myprotechsite.com.
Hey, this is Joe Perez, owner at ProTech. Just reminding you that ProTech Carpet and Tile Care is your professional choice.
Business that needs to get noticed? Your ideas need a great website. And at Infuse, we build simple, clean, and efficient websites. We believe that even the wildest ideas should come to life in a beautiful way. We build responsive sites, e-commerce sites, and even help with business email setup and search engine optimization. Every great idea needs a great website. Start your new look today. Check us out at www.infuse.com. That's www.enfuse.com. Or call us at 800-542-4783. Again, that's 800-542-4783. Infuse, we get it done.
Located in Monrovia, California, Mount Sierra College prepares highly skilled graduates for careers in management, information technology, media arts, and game arts. Transfer earned credits or start right after high school and earn a bachelor's degree in 4 years or less. Combine industry-driven, hands-on small classes with your general education units. Mount Sierra College. Invest in yourself. Financial aid is available for those who qualify.
Thanks for tuning in to Real Estate Rant Radio.
Make sure to join us every Wednesday at 3:30 p.m. on the Rant Radio Network,
where we talk about solutions to your real estate problems.
All right, and we are back here to Real Estate Rant, here at the towers of the Rant Radio Network. I'm your host, Mr. Alex Alanise, and in-house today we have Mr. Which I Can and Mrs. Giselle Mata, just in case your husband has to be watching.
Okay.
How come you need to say that? But anyway... Thank you for joining us here with the last segment of the Real Estate Rant here on the Rant Radio Network, November 11th. I should say that just in case anybody happens to be watching the show. You can win a $25 gift card to Stevens Steakhouse located in the City of Commerce. Compliments of 82 for the Commerce Industrial Council. We are doing an open forum today. Yes, I will try to do this maybe once a quarter, I'm thinking, and invite some guests in, get some opinions about current events and controversial issues. Feel free to give us a call at 855-693-4897, or you can email us at realestaterantradio@gmail.com. We will try to air your questions
Excellent.
Or comments. Thank you, sir. We will try to air your questions or comments during the show, in subsequent shows. We won't be able to do it this show, but in subsequent shows. Now, we were talking at the last segment about the minimum wage, and I just wanted to give my opinion about some of the things that are talked about minimum wage, because this is an age-old argument. And I think that we've seen some of the hikes in minimum wage, because minimum wage wasn't always $8 or $9 or $10, whatever it is now. At one point, it was $5 or $6, right? And it's gone up over the years, mainly because of what we call the future value of the dollar. The dollar depreciates on a regular basis. And so, obviously, and we can use this analogy, we all paid a couple of dollars for a Big Mac when we were little. You know, I want to say it was even 50 cents at one point. But now it's about $3 or $4 to buy a Big Mac. Well, what happened? The Big Mac's exactly the same, but what changed? What changed is the value of the dollar. You need more of them to buy the Big Mac. Now, on one side of the tortilla, from my side of town, Giselle would take the position is like, hey, we need to pay our people more money to buy that Big Mac, right? On the other side of the tortilla, well, you have the entrepreneurs, business owners, corporate Shark Tank people that are interested in saving money on wages, and so they would like to see the what's the word I'm looking for? The minimum wage. They would like to see the minimum wage drop, or either that or stay the same. So you have two trains of thought. You have one train of thought that says, well, if you do that, we're going to have to lay off people, and we will not be able to hire as many people and potentially even get machinery to do the same job. What is your response to that, Giselle?
Well, I say that's already happening. I mean, the federal minimum wage right now is $7.25. It's been that way since, 2009. California is $9 an hour. So when you factor in the cost of living and the price of gas and the continual fluctuation of gas and, even a gallon of milk is $5 in a gallon right now. So you have to consider the fact that it's already happening with stagnant wages. So if that's the premise, then we need to catch up. Essentially, we're just trying to catch up.
So you're saying we need to make additional monies because of the things that are going up in price. I just mentioned the Big Mac. I mean, that's just a microcosm compared to everything else that's out there, including new technologies and new things that are coming out that everybody wants, right?
Right. So what you see now is the growth of those industries that are catering to the poor and moderate families. 99-cent stores doing huge business. Payday loans doing huge business. Car, what do you call those guys that you could trade your car note in?
Title loans.
Title loans. Yeah, title loans. All of these industries that are capitalizing on high interest rates to loan money to folks that are hanging on the edge of our society and are just, a couple of paychecks away from being homeless themselves. And what we talked about previously as far as, the cost of rents going up across the city, there's a real crisis going on. So you've got Andy Bales, who runs the missions down in L.A., wanting Jerry Brown to declare a state of emergency for the housing situation right now. So we are at a crisis. It's just the media, focuses on other things. But really, when you consider what's happening in the downtown area, you don't see where California or LA County leads the nation in its homeless population. So something has to give, and wages seems to be a good place to start.
So now there's a word kind of floating around a little bit in real estate, and that's millennials. Have you guys heard that word?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right on. So I pulled something up here on Google where it says, born between 1980 and 2000 and baby boomers born between 1946 and 1964 will drive real estate decision-making and their preferences about where and how to live. So I think that we're kind of touching on that a little bit in terms of some of those changes that are now happening, because now you have an influx of population and a lack of money. So I think that goes along with what we were talking about earlier in terms of the gap between the rich and the poor. That that middle class is kind of disappearing.
I would agree with that. And the fact that you're seeing that more millennials are so debt heavy with a lack of minimum wage and being so debt heavy coming out of college, if you go to a 4-year university, that's what, $120,000 easily on your debt. You're seeing that.
And 4 years is a short amount of time.
Absolutely.
There's six, maybe there's 8 years. Yeah.
Correct. And so when we look at that, that's going to be, our millennials are going to be our biggest drivers. Obviously, our baby boomers are still going to be the educators and really kind of educate our millennials into, what our next coming decade is going to look like. But at the end of the day, our millennials are what we have to worry about, because, listen, they're so debt heavy. We have a income problem where people are still barely just making it to survive, and now you're seeing that they're just clustering up. You're seeing groups of individuals that, instead of buying your own and starting a family, now you're investing in buying 4, 5, 6 people trying to buy a house so they could live together and make it.
Yeah, so, it's all those co-borrowers.
Correct.
That you have to get. Yeah.
Yeah. So that, in our industry, obviously it's frowned upon. But look, the true reality is that's how our millennials are ending up being, is having to join forces and buy a home because they can't afford it on their own.
All right. So new subject. You probably. I love this article. I saw this this funny on Google. I was kind of looking around some stuff. Land of Milk and Honey. Have you been talking to a realtor up there? It's supposed to be Moses, right?
Right.
Coming down. Another funny that I remember, it was on History of the World with Mel Brooks. He comes down with three tablets. and he's walking down and he kind of slips a little bit. And one of the tablets falls over and cracks. And in the middle of it, he says, I have 15 and it falls over and he says, and it breaks and he goes, 10 commandments, you know. That is just too funny. Yeah, that's hilarious. But anyway, I wanted to bring this up. Last segment of the show, so I figured this is a topic that I am always felt strongly about in terms of flipping properties. And it looks like our good friend, Mr. Trump, has done it again. You probably won't be surprised to learn, if you didn't already know, that Donald Trump started a university, or at least that's what he calls it. And if it may not be surprising that Trump University caused a lot of controversy, so much, in fact, that he's now embroiled into two lawsuits. Okay, and this is now this is not current news. This started in 2013. So what did Trump do? Well, he created a university. That's what he called it, and it's about investing in property. And what he did was he solicited individuals that were interested in now investing in the university and now becoming students, if you will. And then Trump hired some individuals to teach these people to go out, and apparently did not go along with what he was advertising. You know, he claimed that he had a lot of secrets on how to invest in property and how to make big money, like he has. I mean, he's made a lot of good decisions. A lot of bad ones too, because some of the research that I've done, Trump actually filed bankruptcy 5 or 6 times through different corporations. So I think those were probably bad decisions on his part. So nobody's perfect, and neither is Trump. But now, looking at the situation here, this is kind of what I've always said about these programs. I've said it many times throughout the years of doing the show and talking with different individuals. A lot of people are kind of drawn into this celebrity, if you will, about being an investor and flipping properties and being able to do this stuff. But it actually takes a very unique individual to be able to know and deal with contractors, deal with how to invest your money, where to invest your money, not to be taken by somebody that's telling you what something is worth, because you have to be able to do your own research on things. And this is where you kind of rely on your own professionals, but a lot of people don't do that. They don't pay attention to some of the things that they're even being taught in those programs. These individuals simply want to sell a program. That's what I've seen 20 of them.
Now, to play devil's advocate on that, one of the things that you look at is if we take a look at the market, he started a university to show how to flip properties. Now, if you take it that, consider that maybe he started this 3-4 years ago when appreciation rates were 15-16%, that was a great time to be able to show those flips. Now, if those individuals are doing it in today's market, you're only going to see a very slim margin. So when were hiccups presented, or when were what he said didn't work happen? Was it when it was at the prime of an increase in
the first lawsuits was started in 2013, so I'm assuming, let's just say 2011 maybe, where this program was presented to real estate professionals as well as entrepreneurs and investors. And the program, I think, was right in the middle of a recovery. So if anything, it was actually during a good time. Yep, and there was a lot of people doing it. There was an influx of money that came in, as well as, and I've seen this in other articles, that there's an influx of money coming from other countries. You know, we hear about China. The Chinese.
Yeah.
We hear about the Dutch coming in, Russians. This money is coming in large buckets, if you will, buying up property because, you know, they see the trends. They see the trends. But now you have an individual here who sees an opportunity, and you know, hey, we all know who he is. You know, Mr. Trump, you know, he ventured off into something else, created a university, and he was charging anywhere from $1,500 to $35,000 for this program.
Oh.
And you know, hey, if you see Trump's name on something, you would think that it's credible and that it's viable, right? And would you pay $35,000 potentially to get into something like that? So anyway, thank you guys for joining me here on the show. I'll try to do another open forum here in a couple of months. Hopefully all the listeners enjoyed it. Coming up today at 5 o'clock, the Three Guys Rant here on the Rant Radio Network.
Great time. Thank you, Giselle.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Rangers, this is Zordon.
Hi, this is Billy Garcia.
This is